I get a very odd but pleasurable honor this afternoon. I get to welcome you on behalf of two AAASs. One is the American Association for the Advancement of Science, in whose home you are sitting. Welcome. The other is the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and I'm sorry that Leslie Berlowitz, my colleague who's the CEO of the other AAAAS, as we refer to each other, is actually not feeling well and hasn't been able to come. But she did send me some notes of comments she was going to make, and if you don't mind, I will go through them on her behalf. But I will say I have some credential and credibility to welcome you on behalf of both, since not only am I the CEO here, but I am a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. That must be why they decided to tolerate me doing this. Let me say a few things about the American Academy. John Adams, James Bowdoin, John Hancock, and other leaders who contributed to the establishment of our nation founded the Academy in 1780. Based in Cambridge, Massachusetts, that AAAS is an independent policy research center focused on some of our most pressing global challenges. The Academy not only is a tremendous honor for people who are elected to it, but it studies such emerging problems areas as science, technology, policy, global security, humanities, education, social policy. It has projects ongoing in the global nuclear future, the legal, social, and economic trade-offs of alternative energy choices, cybersecurity, protecting the Internet as a public commons, science and the liberal arts curriculum, and a variety of other kinds of events. We're here today to talk about a project that's a part of a larger series of activities resulting from a completed project on science and the media, a topic closely related to today's activities. It's interesting that, and some of you have heard me speak about this before, that we are living at a time where we're either coming through or experiencing some substantial tension between science and the rest of society. And although it has felt over the last decade or so to be not only of concern, but to be relatively new for many of us, certainly of my generation, of course, controversies about science and technology are not new. Copernicus, Galileo, Darwin, and others have elicited rather high-intensity emotional responses from policymakers, at times from the clergy and at times from the general public. And there's been major concern from many organizations, including both of our AAASs, about this issue. And typically, the attitude is that what's needed is greater public understanding of science. And if, in fact, the poor, ignorant public just understood science, everything would be fine, and therefore we should just educate them near to death. Well, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences has engaged in what I think is a rather visionary and ingenious study focusing on the reverse, scientists understanding the public. Those of us who believe in public engagement with science understand what it means is the public understanding science, but scientists understanding the public, and then an attempt to seek common ground wherever possible. That does not necessarily mean agreement, but it means greater understanding and the ability to work and live together. And that's the project that we're going to talk about today, scientists' understanding of the public. Bob Fry, over here, is going to be the moderator and will describe how the Academy went about posing the question, how can scientists and engineers do a better job of engaging in conversation with the public? I can't imagine people in this room don't know who Bob Fry is. Bob Fry has had a distinguished career here in Washington. He served for 10 years as president of resources for the future. He is now a visiting scholar there. He was the first deputy administrator of the Environmental Protection Agency and of what used to be called ERDA, the Energy Research and Development Administration. He was director of the National Museum of Natural History. He is a long-term friend of AAAS, both AAASs. He's a fellow of that AAAS and I believe of ours as well. I hope so. And he will be joined this afternoon by Chris Mooney. Bob will introduce Chris in a more formal way, but let me just say that I have found him to be one of the most visionary, courageous, and insightful science journalists operating these days. He always has something interesting and provocative to say, and I hope that this afternoon's conversation will live up to the standard I just set for them. So with great pleasure, Bob Fry.